Hey everyone, let's take a look at free response number 3. So here we have the number of polio cases in the world are shown in the table for various years. Let f of t be the number of polio cases in thousands. So that means that in 1988, we didn't have 350 cases, we had 350,000 cases. So just keep that in mind. All right, and then it says we want to go t years since 1980. So there is my base year, and they're asking me to get an exponential model. So keep in mind, if you have your base year, you want to make sure that you're not actually entering these values into L1. We want to set a base year of 1980. And how you find your t value is always you take whatever year you're dealing with and subtract your base year. So for this first data point, if I had 1988 as my current year or the year I'm dealing with, and I subtract my base year, I would get t equaling 8, right? And we can fill this in as I scroll down here. I'm just going to subtract 8 basically, or I should say 1980 from each of these, not subtract 8. This would be 24 years after, this is 28 years after 1980, 31 years, and then finally this is 37 years. And I think I want to mention that one of the most common errors I see on these regression problems is that students will put the actual year in and not pay attention to this base year direction. So make sure you're doing that. And let me go over to my calculator and show you how you can do that on your calculator. So here's what I mean. When I go to run this on my calculator, let me clear that out. I put the data into my lists, right? Now you can see I put the actual year in there, and I was just saying don't do that. And I just want to show you how you can fix this. If you go up into L1 and redefine it, I'm going to redefine this as L1 minus my base year of 1980. In a moment, I'm going to hit enter, and you're going to see L1 auto-populate with the t values, right? So there they are. So you can just do that and then have your calculator subtract your base year in your lists for you. All right, so from there, let's go run exponential regression. So I'm gonna hit stat calc. Now on this calculator, again, the app's a little different from the physical calculator, it's option A. I believe on the physical calculator, it's option 0. But let me go L1 against L2. And let's store it in Y1 just in case I need to use it later. I'm gonna overwrite what was there. All right, and if I look, there's my A value and my base value. So I can see I actually have a little bit of exponential decay because my base is less than 1. But let me go copy that over because that's my answer for part A here. All right, so if I start to look at this, we had let me get my pen up. A was 4306.170, and my base was, again, 0.733. So just taking a note, right, this is decay because your base value is less than 1. All right, but if I want to write this up and I want to use the letters given to me, I'm going to say f of t is going to be equal to 4306.170 times 0.733 to the t. That's my exponential function or my exponential model that I'm looking at. All right, and it says, use this exponential model to predict the number of cases in 2019. And again, I think the biggest error I would see that I have seen is students will plug in 2019 right here. And you might be thinking, well, isn't that correct? Not quite. It's on the right track. But the problem is the fact that you're plugging in 2019 and not the actual t value, right? We need the value of t. And how you find that is, again, you always take the year you're looking at, which would be 2019. I subtract my base year of 1980, and I find out this is really 39. So that's what I should be plugging in to my function. And let me go ahead and type that out or write that out. All right, and so let's crunch that, and that's going to give me the number that I'm looking for. So let me move this just so we have it somewhere else. All right, so let's see if I can't find this number. And I'll do it a couple of ways on here. Let me clear this out. So I'm going to do 4306.170 times 0.733, and we're going to raise that to the 39th power. And it looks like I have about 0.024. which is fine. So I'm going to put this then, let me get my pen up. This is going to be 0.024. And again, this is thousands of polio cases. Cases. I spelled that really well. Now, if you want to find out how many cases it actually is, multiply it by 1,000. So if I take 0.024 and I multiply that number by 1,000, let me just do that on my calculator. I'm going to multiply this by 1,000. It's actually pretty close to about 24 polio cases that year. Okay, great. Let me write 24. 24. That's the number I wanted, 24 polio cases. All right, so we've got 24 polio cases. And if you didn't think to do that, that's fine. You could have also written 0.024,000 polio cases. So either way is fine. You keep the original units or you convert them. And one other thing I want to mention is if you want, you can actually go into your calculator. Let me go ahead and turn this plot on. I don't have it on right now. So let me go L1 against L2. And let me go ahead and graph this. Now, again, I'm on my app, so it's a little bit different. There we go with my graph, my equivalent of Zoom 9. If I want to calculate a value, again, I can plug in this X value of 39. And we see that the Y value, you can see it there, is 0.0236, or again, 0.024. So you can use your calculator to take care of that too. You would get closer to about 23.7 cases if you're looking at it this way, but either of those answers is totally fine. All right, so let's take a look here. It says predict when there will be one case of polio. Now, I want you to take a look at the units here. This is cases, right? Not thousands of cases. So we're going to have to convert that. So if we have one case of polio, that's like saying one out of 1,000 if we do thousands of cases. And I have to convert those units because that's the original units for my function. And that's the units that we were using for our model. So I'm going to take my model of 4306.170 times 0.733 to the T and set it equal to 1 out of 1,000. And I'm not going to use my calculator until the bitter end, just because the sooner I start rounding off on decimals, the less precise my answer is going to be at the end. So the first thing I want to do, since I have an exponential equation, and I say exponential because my variable is up in the exponent, is I want to isolate this exponential term. So let me divide both sides by 4306.170. All right, so we're going to get here that 0.733 to the T is whatever this number is, 1 over 1,000 divided by 4306.170. Since I have my exponential expression isolated, what I can do is I can log both sides now, and that's exactly what I'm going to do. So I'm going to take the ln of both of these sides, all right? And what that allows me to do is bring this exponent down as multiplication. So I know T times ln of 0.733 is going to equal the natural log of, and this is a fun little argument here, 1 over 1,000 divided by 4306.170, right? And so if I want to solve for T, I'm going to divide both sides by ln of 0.733. And I know this is a lot. And we're just going to enter all this in our calculator because it's a bunch of number crunching. So T is going to equal this fun ratio of the natural log of 1 over 1,000 divided by 4306.170, and then the natural log of 0.733. All right, so let's do it. Let's find the T value, right? And then I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to round my answer. I know this says month and year. We're just going to go with year. I will correct that in post. All right, so let's take a look at, hold up, let's go for it. So we're going to go ahead. Let's get out of this screen. Let me hit done. So I'm going to do the natural log of 1 out of 1,000 divided by 4306.170, right? And then I'm going to divide that by the natural log of 0.733. And when I hit enter, I'm getting about 49.179. Okay, great. Let me write that down. So this is going to be 49.179. Now that I'm going to say is pretty close to 49 years. But again, this is 49 years after 1980. So if I want to find out my actual year, we're going to take our base year of 49 and this time add 1980 to it and find out that we're basically looking at 2029. So that's what I'm looking for here. Now, if you wanted to do it a different way, if you wanted to do all of this on your calculator, which you could go in here and on your other Y, I go with Y sub 2, I can enter in that 1 out of 1,000. And you can kind of see it. Actually, let me see if I can change the color on it just so we can see it a little bit differently. Yeah, let me make that red. If I go to my graph there, you can see that red line. And you can try and figure out where they intersect, but it's going to be a good time. You got to get all the way over here, and you can barely, really can have, in my opinion, have trouble seeing it. And as I start to look, I'm seeing that this particular app is not good at figuring out the intersections, because it should have happened somewhere around, oh, actually, now that I say this, let me go ahead and zoom out a bit. Let's go to 49 and see if it locks on an intersection point. Oh, it does. It does say the intersection point, or it'll show it graphically, but unfortunately it's not giving me the coordinates, which is what you really want, right? Oops, I'm having fun with this app. It is not, oops. Oh my goodness, I'm just failing at all of this. Well, I'm not failing, but I'm having trouble getting the app to work. Yeah, there's the intersection, but it's just not telling me what that value is. So maybe that's not possible in this app. So I'm gonna stop this screencast, because I'm not seeing a way to get the intersection on the graph screen, but there is that option on the physical calculator. So I'm seeing some limitations in this calculator app, which is good to learn. All right, so with all of that, here is our answer, right? 2029, and I'm gonna just stick with the algebra side of things rather than the graphing calculator way to get the answer, because at least this way we got the answer. All right, thanks so much, everyone. Bye.